Hello, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us for this special edition of our RSAC 365 live stream. Thank you for tuning in. I'm your host, Casey Zirkus, with the RSA conference team, and today I am talking with Michael Garcia, who was a recipient of the inaugural hashtag Share the Mic in Cyber Fellowship grant. Take a moment to tell New America Fellowship, and then we'll dive into the research paper that you just published.
Yeah, absolutely. And thank you for having me join us today. It's really amazing to be part of this podcast and the live streaming. So my name is Michael Garcia. I've been in the cyber community for a number of years, working on a host of policy issues. Currently, my day job is working with CISA in their policy shop. But I've been doing this in my personal capacity, and the Share the Mic initiative really started off through a series of Twitter conversations in which folks in the Belfer Center and others helped to provide a microphone, if you will, a virtual microphone to those who are underrepresented in the cyber community. That transformed into this inaugural fellowship that launched last year, in which a couple of fellows were selected to write or perform research on a host of cybersecurity topics that interested them. Unfortunately, the paper was just released, and that's why I'm here today to talk about some of my findings. So it's really great to be part of this discussion.
Yeah, I'm super excited to have you. And I know I did read your paper. So the paper that you published is the Forgotten Emerging Technology, the Metaverse, and its Cybersecurity Implications. Super interesting is the amount of time that you spent just defining what the Metaverse is. Because, you know, I sort of had this concept in my head of this working definition of what it was, but it really has a lot of different tentacles, if you will, that include AR, VR, MR. Why did you think it was so important to define the Metaverse as the starting point of the paper?
Yeah, no, I mean, it's a great question, and it's one that I actually struggle with. I talk to a lot of folks about, you know, we should just go straight into the cybersecurity aspects and its uses. But increasingly, when I was doing the research, there was no consensus on what the Metaverse even is. And so in my mind, if you can't even have an agreement on what we're trying to talk about, how can we talk about the challenges and then even potential solutions? And I think really we're seeing this akin to artificial intelligence, right? Mm-hmm. Everyone is slapping on AI on a box and saying, it's AI, look at this. Right. And I think before ChatGPT, the Metaverse was kind of the shiny object, and everyone was, there's so many ads out there about what the Metaverse was or was not. So what I wanted to do was to explore what some of these ideas that might have been more about commercialization and also those that are about the technology itself. And by distilling that, it then helps identify the core technologies that then allow for the conversation to flourish about what kind of cyber attack vectors are out there for the bad actors to exploit. And part of it too was then to help confine what is within the Metaverse construct and what is out. And part of that was trying to distill the notion that the Metaverse isn't just a headset you put on and you're in this immersive virtual reality, but could be as simple as using your phone and placing a sofa in your living room. It could be as simple as that, and its capabilities that we see to this day. So as part of that, it's showing that this is why the title says, quote unquote, emerging technology, because it's something that we've been using and dealing with for a long time, but never really thought about it in a construct called the Metaverse. So it is a lengthy conversation, but I think one that was hopefully useful to help shape the rest of the paper about the challenges and potential solutions when it comes to the cybersecurity of the Metaverse.
Yeah, and laying that groundwork certainly for me did help me to think about sort of the grand scale of what we're talking about, right? Because I think a lot of people do have that perception that like it's putting on a headset, but you know that as you point out, there are many different use cases for it. So you did suggest that the Metaverse technologies will likely have a significant global impact with critical infrastructure entities using different extended reality technologies. Can you elaborate on the different ways the Metaverse may be used?
Absolutely. And so for context, at least in the United States arena, we have 16 critical infrastructure sectors. And these are the sectors in which there are assets and systems that if they were to be debilitated or severely impacted, that it would severely impact the nation's security, economy, health, public safety of Americans. And so what I wanted to do was to say, you know, how widespread could the metaverse be used? And I found that it could be used in nearly all sectors. And in some cases, they're currently being used. One interesting example is that in Australia, actually, since 2017, again, so it's been about five, 6+ years, they use a digital schematic of a water utility to help them identify where they're going to be increased efficiencies, where there'd be potential security flaws, physical security flaws, that is, as well as cybersecurity flaws. And what that really touches on is this important concept that I touch on the paper about digital twins, which is basically just a digital avatar of yourself or of a larger water plant or even a city. So for example, Seoul in South Korea has invested millions of dollars to create a digital Seoul in which you can either use your phone or a headset or even just going online to access a digital Seoul to get a marriage certificate or a birth certificate or any other types of government services. And most importantly, though, is that at least in the US context, and we'll give later to this about how China uses it, but the military is increasingly and has always relied on aspects of extended reality technologies, which encompasses the underpinning of the metaverse. And this has been happening since at least the 1950s. And you just think about the helmets that the fighter pilots use. And if anyone's played any video games or then any of these simulations, you put the headset on and you can really see the GPS, your coordinates, gas fuelage, things of that nature. And that's a form of augmented reality. And we've been using that for decades. And the military has increasingly, especially in this administration, seeing the metaverse as a real good opportunity to improve training and combat simulation and other types of military aspects to improve our military readiness. And by taking the time to delve into the notion that the metaverse is more than just video games or, you know, Pokemon Go and trying to capture Pokemon out in the public, that then allows the conversation of, okay, what would happen if there was a cybersecurity attack on these devices that's more than just someone can't access a birth certificate or a marriage certificate, but actually it would have profound impact about how our critical infrastructure actually operates.
Absolutely right. And so for the RSAC community, the greater concern is obviously that cybersecurity aspect that you touch upon. And you definitely know within the paper the potential of new cyber threats, writing, while a hacker could use an existing attack method to inflict pain on a victim, they could also exploit new vulnerabilities within XR technologies. So can you maybe give some examples of that for those joining us today? And I love there are questions coming in and we'll get to those in the chat, but maybe give some examples for our listeners.
Yeah. So we could start about the novel threat, and immediately people think about the headset. And, you know, I think I equate it to, we all had some security and privacy concerns with Alexa being in the room and they say, "Hey, Alexa, it'll listen," but obviously it's always listening for that phrase. And so there's been reports about how it's always listening. Well, similar to a headset, right? You're basically taking an Alexa type, and I don't want to say it's just Alexa, but other home assistants, if you will, on your head, and it's constantly listening, right? So if you ever used any type of headset, you understand that you can use vocal, verbal, physical movements in order to use whatever system you're using for that particular headset. And so researchers from LSU, Rutgers, and others have found that there are various vulnerabilities, either through hardware or software, and even from using software attacks from the provider that's providing the apps for you to use the headset, not necessarily the headset itself, that allows then for a bad actor to potentially track your retinal movements, to actually map the room in which you are in with the headset to capture the audio. And to be sure, these are big privacy concerns from a user standpoint. But again, we take it back to the context of a critical infrastructure owner and operator, and that if you are using digital schematics for, say, an airport, that could be really troublesome. So that's one key issue. In addition to the headset is the supply chain notion. And what I really wish I did the paper, and I actually would really hope people take this on, is diving deeper into supply chain challenges. So not only like the semiconductors, right? So the same chips that we've been having conversations about that power our cars, our computers, and every other IoT devices are the same exact chips that are going to be in these headsets. But China also detailed in a recent five-year metaverse plan that they want to be the dominant supplier of the near-eye display, so really the glass, if you will. And if they control that, then you also they can choke off the supply chain for U.S. manufacturing. And the last point I'll just hit on is this notion of the human joystick phenomenon. So if folks remember, I think like 2016, 2017, back when Pokemon Go was a big story. And for folks who weren't part of the gaming community, basically you take your phone, you could download Pokemon Go, and you go outside of your camera, and Pokemon will pop up, and you can capture a Pokemon and have it for your collection. Well, bad actors were able to manipulate the software and were able to say, okay, there's a Pokemon in this dark alleyway, go there. And people were getting robbed. So you were able to physically move someone and do bad things to them physically. The same thing could happen in that you could be in your room and or somewhere else and put something in your visual display that would make you go somewhere and you end up hurting yourself inadvertently. Obviously, that could be way worse if, say, someone in a fighter pilot, their display goes wrong and you could have a really bad incident. So those are at least three of the new type of attack vectors that I explored in the paper.
Yeah. And there was so much that was fascinating about the paper. I really appreciate it also that you took this sort of global approach at looking at what other countries are doing, not only in their quest to be the leaders of this technology in terms of development and getting things to market, but also in terms of policy. And I couldn't help but think, like, wow, the U.S. is really kind of behind the ball here. And, two of the key takeaways specific to the U.S. and the metaverse that you noted are government agencies have little to no initiatives underway explicitly dedicated to securing the metaverse. And despite the creation of a congressional caucus for focusing on the issue, Congress has introduced limited bills to address cybersecurity concerns. Obviously for me, one of the key takeaways of the paper as a whole was, the U.S. really, in terms of policymakers, needs to step up. If you could give U.S. policymakers one immediate action item, the first step that they can take toward making XR technologies part of the national cybersecurity strategy, what would it be? Where do they start?
Yeah, and I think one big caveat I'll place that these are just my own personal views and doesn't represent the government views, realizing my day job's with the government. So that aside, I think first and foremost, we need to be part of the international conversation. I think what struck me was that the UN, through the International Telecommunications Union, or the ITU, actually has a focus group on the metaverse. And they have a series of sub-working groups where basically they're convening the international community saying, this is an important issue, let's get ahead of it, and let's start creating interoperability standards, privacy considerations, security considerations. So actually very thoughtful conversations. The United States is not part of any of those working groups. While we chair the ITU, we are not part of any of the focus groups or sub-working groups conversations. More alarming, and this is kind of a throwback to the 5G conversations, which I'm sure the audience will appreciate, is that China, unshockingly, is very much a part of these working groups. They actually hosted the second forum meeting this past July in Shanghai. So they understand the importance of controlling that narrative. And so the United States very much needs to be part of that conversation. There's a host of associations here in the US in which the United States government can partner with to ensure that we do have voice in the international community. And that stems then to the second point, in that we also need to think holistically about what we want to do within the United States and how we want to partner with our private sector partners. You mentioned how I explored some issues with other countries. And this is a model that the EU has adopted, the UK, South Korea, Japan, and others that I didn't have time to explore. But clearly other countries see this as an issue, and the United States is going to end up having to play catch up, and at worst, going to have to then react to new regulations or new incentives that other countries are putting out there, rather than being leaning forward and creating our own policies that can then help lead the rest of the world in how they view this issue.
And I'm just, hypothetically spitballing here, but I'm wondering if, because I'm looking at, one of the questions from our viewers, do you think that the metaverse will have any real use in the real world? It actually feels like it's only use in the gaming world. And I almost wonder if that's sort of a short-sightedness of the U.S. in terms of policy. Like, do we unfortunately see it as, it's military use or it's gaming, and there's kind of no real practical use in between, and that's why we're not focused on policy? Or I don't know.
Yeah, I think, and this goes back to definition issues, because when I first started this, I got the exact same question, like, Michael, you're wasting your time. Like, only the gaming community uses it, and then the military, they got it figured out, which neither things are true. So part of it is realizing that it's not just a headset, right? Once again, we're talking about every user has access to some form of augmented reality.
Am I correct in understanding that, like, even the virtual background that we use in our Zoom meetings would be considered a form of, okay, all right.
Absolutely, absolutely. That is spot on. And thinking about artificial intelligence, I know that, so Axios, for example, they put out, the newsletter today about how various AI communities are putting together, once again, the smart glasses, if you will, to have AI chatbots in your frames. That's a form of augmented reality, right? And so what you're going to end up having is that AI is going to merge with extended reality technologies. And while we're focused on the AI concerns, rightfully so, there are still a host of issues with the metaverse that we're not necessarily seeing. And they go hand in hand. So you're always, if I'm an attacker, okay, you have really strong controls here, I can still do what I want to do over here. So while the application is maybe not as widespread as we may think, again, I'll point another example outside of Australia. In the EU, there's a consortium of medical professionals in which they're trying to already do virtual reality sessions of surgeries, right? So these aren't complex surgeries yet, but how can you basically do more than zooming in another professional from a different country on a surgery where you need their expertise? That's already happening. So whether the United States, views this as a critical issue or not, the rest of the world does. And part of this, unfortunately, when I spell it on paper, is that the market hype beat out the practical use. And as a result, due to, basically quarterly stock downturns, in which you have Meta kind of pivoting, Disney laid out their whole metaverse staff, if you will. We're seeing this short-term market impact, like, that's not gonna be a thing, and not the longer picture like other countries are viewing it as.
Yeah. It's really a fascinating paper. And listeners, if you have not had a chance to review it, I did put the link in the chat. Again, the title is of our script, The Forgotten Emerging Technology, the Metaverse and its Cyber. You can find it at New America under Michael Garcia. Here, so excited to see the work that is happening with Share the Mic and Cyber as part of New America. And I love seeing these fellowships evolve, and I'm fascinated by the topics that folks are choosing to do some research work on and help to move things forward. So thank you for being here. Listeners, thank you for tuning in. To find products and solutions related to policy and government or the metaverse, we invite you to visit rsaconference.com/marketplace. Here you'll find an entire ecosystem of cybersecurity vendors and service providers who can assist with your specific needs. Please keep the conversation going on your social channels using the hashtag RSAC, and be sure to visit rsaconference.com for new content posted year-round. Take care, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.